नमस्ते बिटिया, माई सेल्फ जेवी नेहा सैनी फ्रॉम फिजियोथेरेपी एंड डायग्नोस्टिक्स, ज्योति विद्यापीठ वुमेन्स यूनिवर्सिटी। हेयर आई एम गोइंग टू टेल यू अबाउट द एनाटॉमी ऑफ द स्टमक। फर्स्ट यू शुड नो अबाउट द जनरल स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ द GIT। GIT मीन्स गैस्ट्रो इंटेस्टाइनल ट्रैक, दैट इज योर डाइजेस्टिव सिस्टम। सो देर आर फोर लेयर्स इन द GIT। द इनर मोस्ट इज द म्यूकोजा, इट कंटेन्स एपिथीलियम, बिलो डैट लमाइना प्रोप्रिया, below that we have the muscularis mucosae. So these are the three layers of the mucosa. Below the mucosa or outside the mucosa we have submucosa. It is made up of connective tissue, blood vessels, lymphatic vessels and nerve plexus, and at some places glands are also found. Outside the submucosa we have muscularis externa. It is composed of inner circular and outer longitudinal smooth muscle fibers. Then outside that we have the serosa, or we can say the adventitia. This is the serosa. It is formed by the mesentery, that is the peritoneal fold. So the four layers are included in this diagram: the mucosa, outside that we have some mucosa, then muscularis externa and serosa. Now come to the anatomy of the stomach. The stomach is a dilated part of the alimentary canal and is located between the esophagus and the small intestine. It is a muscular sac. It is J-shaped, as we can see. It is capital J in shape. And the capacity of the stomach in case of children, it is 30 ml. In adults, it is 1.5 to 2 liters. The stomach occupies the left upper quadrant, epigastric, umbilical regions, and much of it lies under the cover of ribs. Stomach is located at the level of T10 and L3 vertebrae. The position varies with body habit, like in case of healthy people who are very heavier in weight, the shape must be horizontal in the obese persons, while it is capital J shape in case of thin persons. So according shape their position may vary. The stomach is divided into four regions, that is cardia, which surrounded the opening of the esophagus into the stomach. So here we can see the cardia. All regions are highlighted with different colors, so there is no confusion. Then the fundus of the stomach, which is the area above the level of the cardiac orifice. Cardiac orifice means this opening. The body of stomach, which is the largest region, pyloric part. This is the pyloric part. So, which is divided into pyloric antrum and the pyloric canal. So pyloric antrum is towards the body, and pyloric canal is towards the duodenum, that is the small intestine. So here we can see the structure of the stomach: the cardiac part, fundus, body and pyloric part. So these are again depicted in this diagram. Now the surfaces of the stomach. There are two surfaces: anterior superior and the posterior inferior surface. In the diagram we can see the anterior superior surface. Then openings of the stomach. There are two openings in the stomach: gastroesophageal openings leading to the esophagus, and another is pyloric opening leading to duodenum. Then the sphincters. There are two sphincters in the stomach. Sphincters are the gatekeepers which keep on guarding the entry and the exit of different substances into and outside the stomach. So these are the sphincters. First is the cardiac sphincter, which is found at the lower end of the esophagus. So this is the cardiac sphincter. It closes off the top end of the stomach. It is a physiological sphincter. Basically, it is a physiological sphincter. It is not an anatomical sphincter. Anatomical means it is not visible in the diagram or any other viscera.
while anatomical sphincters are those sphincters which are visible clearly in the viscera. These are anatomical sphincters. Cardiac sphincter is a physiological sphincter and pyloric sphincter is a anatomical sphincter. Pyloric sphincter closes off at the bottom of the stomach. Now, how the cardiac sphincter is formed? Here we can see the lower esophageal sphincter is a ring of muscle relaxes to let the food into the stomach and tightens to prevent the regurgitation. At the lower end of the esophagus, these muscles, these are acting as cardiac sphincter. There is no special other structure, anatomical structure, which is guarding this opening. So here we can see the cardiac sphincter. Again, it is also supported by, this sphincter is also supported by the diaphragm. So the cardiac sphincter is formed by the muscles at the lower end of the esophagus and the muscles of the diaphragm. Now next is the pyloric sphincter. Here we can see the muscles of the stomach itself, they reduplicate and forms a thickened sphincter which is known as pyloric sphincter. So pyloric sphincter is formed by the reduplication of the smooth muscle fibers at the lower part of the stomach. Now sphincters keep the food and gastric juices in the stomach until desired release. Cardiac sphincter, it prevents the backflow into the esophagus, and pyloric sphincter, it controls the movement into the intestine, small intestine. In the stomach we have two curvatures, greater curvature which is a point of attachment of the gastrosplenic ligament and greater omentum. So in the diagram we can see this is the greater curvature and this is the lesser curvature. Lesser curvature gives attachment to the lesser omentum. Then there are two notches, cardiac notch and angular notch. Cardiac notch is the superior angle created by the esophagus at the entry into the stomach, and the angular notch, it is a bend on the lesser curvature of the stomach. Now come to the interior of the stomach. When we open the stomach, we find the rugae. Rugae are found on the interior layer of the stomach and help in breaking down of the food when the stomach contracts. Rugae are the nothing but these are the mucosal folds, and these are temporary in nature. When the stomach fills, they vanish and they reappear when the stomach is empty. Then another structure which is found in the interior of the stomach is gastric canal. Gastric canal has been highlighted here with the green color. It is the longitudinal furrow formed between the longitudinal fold of mucosa at the lesser curvature during swallowing. So gastric canal is found at the lesser curvature, and here there is absence of oblique layer of the muscle, and this area comes in contact with any kind of food you eat, that is why it is prone to gastric ulceration. So first of all, gastric ulceration will be formed at the gastric canal only. Now another structure which we find in the stomach, it is the gastric pit. So in the diagram we can see the small pores, these are the gastric pits. The gastric pits are the small depressions on the mucosal surface in which open the gastric glands. So these are the gastric glands. Gastric glands are the specialized structures which are formed by the epithelial lining of the stomach. So in the diagram, this is the histology of the stomach. Here we can see this is the epithelium. When this epithelium dips down, it forms the gland, and the opening of this gland on the surface is known as gastric pit. So here we can see the structure of the gastric glands, and in the gastric glands we have different kinds of cells like mucous neck cells, parietal cells, gastric gland cells, chief cells. All these cells have different functions. these are enlisted over here. The mucus neck cells, they have the function to secrete the mucus. This mucus acts as a physical barrier between the lumen and the epithelium. It buffers the gastric acid to prevent damage to the epithelium. Then the parietal cells, they will secrete the HCl and intrinsic factor. HCl will activate the pepsin and kills the bacteria in the stomach. An intrinsic factor is needed for the absorption of vitamin B12 in our body. Then we have enterochromaffin-like cells. They will secrete histamine, which stimulate gastric acid secretion. Then the chief cells, they secrete pepsin and gastric lipase. Pepsin digests the proteins and gastric lipase digests the fat. Then we have D cells, they will secrete somatostatin, they inhibits the gastric acid secretion. G cells, they will secrete the gastrin, they stimulate the gastric acid secretion. Now we come to the musculature of the stomach. In the previous slides, we have studied that the wall of the GIT is made up of four layers. So muscularis layer, that is the third layer, it contains the smooth muscle fibers. And these smooth muscle fibers, they are arranged in two forms, inner circular, outer longitudinal. But in the case of stomach, we have three layers of smooth muscle fibers. Innermost is the oblique layer, then we have circular, and the outer is the longitudinal layer of the smooth muscle fiber. So these are the three layers of the smooth muscle fiber. It is only found in the stomach. Oblique layer is the extra layer in the stomach. So here we can see the oblique, then circular, and then outer longitudinal. Now the lesser omentum. In the previous slides we have heard about it, the lesser omentum. It is attaching the liver to the lesser curvature of the stomach, and the greater omentum, it is attaching at the greater curvature of the stomach. So this is the attachments of lesser and the greater omentum. This is the lesser omentum and this is the greater omentum. Greater omentum connects the greater curvature of the stomach to the transverse colon. Transverse colon is what? It is a part of the large intestine. This is the transverse colon, this part, and this is the greater omentum. It hangs like an apron in front of the small intestine. It is folded back on itself to be attached to the transverse colon. It is the largest peritoneal reflection in the body. Then come to the stomach bed. The structures which are related to the posterior inferior surface of the stomach, they will form the stomach bed. So what are the structures? From superior to inferior side, it is formed by the left dome of the diaphragm. So this is the diaphragm. Left dome means, in the diagram we have two domes, two umbrella shaped structures, elevations in the diaphragm. This is the right dome, suppose. This is the right dome, then there is intermediate tendon, and this is the left dome. So left dome of the diaphragm is related to the stomach. Then we have spleen, left suprarenal gland, left kidney, splenic artery, pancreas, transverse mesocolon, transverse colon. All these are forming the stomach bed. Spleen is separated from the stomach by the greater sac of the peritoneum, while other structures are separated from the stomach by the lesser sac. All these structures, that is lesser sac and greater sac, these are again the peritoneal folds. So here we can see all the structures which are forming the posterior bed, that is the stomach bed of the stomach. Now these are the anatomical relations on the anterior aspect of the stomach. Now the blood supply of the stomach. You should remember only the names of the arteries. What are the arteries which are supplying to our stomach? These are left gastric, splenic artery, and common hepatic artery. So these are the three branches. Here we can see the arterial supply of the stomach. It is important. This is the celiac trunk. It is a branch of the abdominal aorta. It provides three branches, that is left gastric, splenic, and common hepatic. Then from these branches, another branches appear and they supply the stomach. For example, from the splenic artery, there arises short gastric artery. Splenic artery also gives origin to left gastroepiploic. So these are the branches which supply on the greater curvature of the stomach. Then left gastric artery supplies the lesser curvature along with the right gastric artery. Right gastric artery is a branch of common hepatic artery. Then this is the gastroduodenal artery. It provides right gastroepiploic branch, which is again supplying to the greater curvature of the stomach. Then we come to the venous drainage. All the arteries, they have corresponding veins which drain into portal vein. So this is the venous drainage of the stomach. All the arteries, they have the corresponding veins, and these veins directly or indirectly draining into the portal vein. This is the lymphatic drainage of the stomach. For the ease, we have divided stomach into four areas. Area number A drains its lymph into pancreaticoduodenal group of lymph nodes. This is pancreaticoduodenal group of lymph nodes. Area number B drains its lymph into superior gastric lymph nodes and suprapyloric group of lymph nodes. Area number C drains its lymph into inferior gastric group of lymph nodes. Then the innervation, that is the nerve supply of the stomach. Stomach is supplied by the right and the left vagus nerve. Vagus nerve is the 10th cranial nerve. So the parasympathetic innervation of the stomach is supplied by the vagus nerve. Vagus nerve forms two trunks, that is anterior and the posterior vagal trunk. Anterior vagal trunk is formed by the left vagal nerve, and posterior vagal trunk is formed by forms the right vagal trunk, and they are having the power of secretion for the gastric juice. They stimulates the secretion of the gastric juice. Then this is the innervation again of the stomach. Now the sympathetic innervation of the stomach is by the splanchnic nerve. It is derived from T6 to T10 spinal nerves. It is vasomotor. It controls the sphincters, action of the sphincters, and it is the chief pathway for the pain. Now come to the clinical anatomy. First is the gastric pain. So pain in the stomach because of any contaminated food and water is the main cause for the gastric infections, which is causing abdominal pain. Then there is pyloric obstruction. If the infant vomits just after meal, so it will because of pyloric stenosis, because the pyloric part of the stomach is not open due to thickening of the pyloric sphincter. This is the sign of gastric carcinoma. It is known as Troisier sign. In this, the left supraclavicular lymph nodes, they are enlarged. This is the signal node. Next is the peptic ulcer. It is a sore on the lining of your stomach. So it is most common in persons with hurry, worry and eat spicy curry. So it is the damage in the mucosa of the gastric. Then this is the endoscopy. It is a procedure to view the interior of the stomach. So in this, we have passed the endoscope through the mouth, then through the esophagus. It is entering into the stomach, and this endoscope has a light delivery system to illuminate the organ at its apex, and the lens system which is transmitting the image to the viewer from the fibroscope. So this is the additional channel to allow the entry of medical instruments and manipulators. Then we have hiatal hernia. The esophagus passes through the diaphragm and into the stomach just inferior to the diaphragm. Here the hiatus is there, which causes anatomic narrowing of this opening of the stomach and helps to prevent
the reflux of the stomach contents into the esophagus. In some patients, this opening is weak. So this is the hiatus. Hiatus means opening. In the diaphragm, we have this opening which is giving passage to the esophagus to continue into the stomach. In some person, this opening is weak or enlarged. So because of weakening or enlargement of this hiatus, the stomach herniates out. It protrudes out into the thoracic cavity. This is known as hiatal hernia. So there are types of hiatal hernia, in which first is the sliding type. It is the most common. It is characterized by upward herniation of the cardia or gastroesophageal junction. So this is the, if there is protrusion of this cardiac part and the gastroesophageal junction, it is known as sliding type of hiatal hernia. Fixed hernia means there is upward herniation of the gastric fundus. So if the fundus comes out into the thorax, it is known as fixed hernia. Complicated type means most of the stomach enters into the thoracic cavity. So this is the complicated type and is more serious and least common hiatal hernia. Now the questions related to this topic, they are: write a detailed account on the anatomical features, blood supply and nerve supply of the stomach. It's a large question. And second question is a short note. Write short note on stomach bed and the interior of the stomach. You have to draw a diagram in both these questions. Now this is the exercise for your file. You have to draw this diagram and label all the structures which are demarcated. Try to find out these all demarcated structure and label them. Then the second exercise is draw a well-labeled diagram of the stomach bed. So you have to draw this diagram, which is the stomach bed diagram. Then the third exercise, you have to draw this diagram of the blood supply of the stomach. It is very important. It can be asked in the form of short note in your exams. So this completes your topic, the anatomy of the stomach. Thank you.